Hello. I never really wanted to do a video because I wasn't sure that I could actually do anything that would be of interest to anybody in this kind of format. Because, first of all, I don't think of myself as any kind of a teacher. I don't want anything that's really in this or anything that I say to be misunderstood. So I don't want to say that what I do is correct or anything. It's just so that you can have some kind of understanding of the way that I feel about music and my own music. And so a lot of this video is just going to be the guys playing. And then also I'm going to show what I consider to be like probably 10 of the most usable scales so that you can play over most anything. Well, this first tune that we're going to play is called Funnels, and I wrote it actually for a different group that we're going to be playing at the Queen Mary Jazz Festival a few years ago. And the Queen Mary has three funnels, and that's why I call the tune Funnels. But we ended up not playing it at that gig, but I wrote the tune specifically for that because each one of the guys was supposed to hand a tune in. And I wrote this tune with the same changes for the head as for the blowing, so that it would be kind of easy for everybody but to play. But it didn't end up that way. But we since then played it with my own band, and well, this is it. We'll be right back. This next tune was actually written by Allan Pasqua. And when I first met Allan, we used to play together in the Tony Williams Lifetime band. And this tune was always good fun to play because it was nice and easy to play over. So it was a good tune for us to open with sometimes, because if everybody was so nervous, you know, if we were in a town where there were lots of musicians or something, then we'd all be trembling. So we'd start with that tune because we could more or less play it. So here it is. This next tune is a tune from the album Atavacron called Looking Glass, and it's based around chords where the intervals are pretty wide. Like, for example, the first few chords are played on the first two strings and the last two strings only. But I like to do that because then you can give each tune a colour rather than just playing the same voicings for, you know, your favourite voicings in every tune. I like to try and make each tune a little more specific than that so that they have a specific thing that happens more or less in that tune alone, and it's not something that's found consistently in any of the other ones. Although there's obviously, because it was my composition, I guess there's some thread of evidence of lunacy in there somewhere. But anyway, this tune starts with these chords. Here it is.
Let's take a break from our in-studio concert and join Allan as he discusses improvising, along with his 10 most useful scales.
Well, I guess in the beginning I wanted to learn how to improvise. I was always interested in that. And I knew that if I wanted to improvise over chord changes, I'd have to figure out, you know, all the scales that went with all those chords. So because I was particularly stubborn, and my dad was always around to help me, but I didn't like to ask him because I wanted to figure it out on my own. Yeah, sure. But so I guess I started out trying to figure everything out by using math. So I started out using a fixed number, like say the number one, because of the transposing nature of stringed instruments, you can transpose real easy, which is something you can't do on other instruments. So I figured if I just started out with, say, five note scales, then I could take, just permutate them all, like 1 through 5, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, etc., through to 12. And then I'd do the same with 6 notes, 7 notes, 8 notes, 9 notes. And then I cataloged them and filed them away and threw away all the ones that had more than 4 semitones in a row, in a straight row. And I just analyzed them and looked at them until I could see chords within them. And then I realized that the way I think about chords is they're just parts of the scale that are played simultaneously. And as the chord changes go by, I don't so much think about a static chord voicing staying or changing. I just see like the whole of the notes on the neck change. And I guess for me, the only thing that makes one scale different from another is not the starting note, it's the separation of the intervals. For example, if it's a D minor major 7 scale, the name which I give to a scale is only a name, is only a means of identification. It's for no other purpose. So when I think of that scale, I don't think of it as starting on D. I think of it as it starts at the lowest available note on my instrument, which would be an E, and the highest available note, which would be another E, the high E. So that's basically how I think of scales. What I've done is I've figured out what I would say would be 10 really usable scales that you could use for playing over most anything. And there are plenty more, believe me, but these I think are the most usable ones. What you see here is all the notes of a C major scale all at once from one end of the guitar to the other. And that's basically how I see scales. I see them from the lowest note to the highest note. I don't have a different name for a different scale that starts on any one of these notes, which there is. You can practically name any scale, come up with a different name from any note that you can start on. But for me, for the way my music is, it didn't really help. It was kind of a hindrance, really. So I abbreviated it to these symbols. And this first one, which means really like a D minor with a natural 6 to me. So that's what this is. And like I said, when I see scales, I see them the whole guitar neck like that. So it's just up to me to juggle the notes around and improvise and make melodies out of them. I think a good way to begin practicing scales basically is to try playing more than 3 notes on a string, just so you can break away from playing in a pattern like this F major or something like that. And just start thinking of it more like that. That way you end up in different parts of the guitar. You know, you can start on the low F and end up on a high A or something. I guess the only thing I can say to help maybe people think about how to look at the whole fingerboard as one and kind of juggle it around is to, if I played something real simple from like just a C major scale, just to maybe you could see that it could go an awful lot further than this. Just as an example of juggling things around. This is a D minor major 7 scale. This is my symbol for that, which is probably completely meaningless to anybody else but me, but that's okay. And what I'm going to do later, actually, and also in the booklet, is to show you how you can find chords in amongst all this, because like I said, I see the whole thing from top to bottom. So I can see these chord shapes in there, you know, like an A augmented chord, and of course the minor major 7. But I guess we'll go into that in more detail in the booklet. All of these scales that I've given here are not the same scales with different names. They're actually different based on the fact that they have different interval permutations. So this scale is an A minor major 7 and a flat 6. This is my symbol for that, which of course, again, is completely meaningless to anyone but me. But this is that scale. This scale is what I call a minor major 7 with a raised 4th. And I like this scale a lot. Some people refer to it as a harmonic major scale. Like if I played this in E, which I used in one tune from a while ago on the old IOU album. There was an E pedal section in a tune called Letters of Mark, was based kind of on this scale, really. And I've heard some people call that scale a B harmonic major, but for me, like I said, I always relate them to the closest minor in my head, if there is anything in my head. This is the crazy symbol that I use for that, and the chords I was talking about were just... All of those chords just come from that one scale. This next scale is a symmetrical scale. It's just what I call a double diminished scale. I think most people just refer to it as a diminished scale. So it's just the this one. The actual name for it is usually a half step away from the name that I use, because I always think of this scale as being related to an altered dominant chord. For example, if I played this scale, which is essentially these notes, it's actually a G sharp diminished chord. But I think of it more as being like a, you know, like a G7 flat 9 chord. So that's why I use that name. Again, like I said, the name might be a little confusing, but the scale is good, it works. Like I said before, you can find all these hidden chords within these scales, and which I'll kind of show you how to find later or and in the booklet. But like this one, for example, it's got these... This scale's a very usable scale because it's very easy to disguise, but at the same time, if you play it in certain other ways, it's too recognizable and sounds pretty lame. So I always try and, with this particular scale, always juggle the notes around a lot so that it's more difficult to identify. But yet, when you're listening to it, you can hear some kind of logic in there. These next three scales are what I just refer to them as, basically kind of like jazz scales, but I don't use these particular three a lot, but I think it's really good to know them, so here they are. This is just like a B flat major scale, but it has the raised fifth in it as well. So essentially that's what that is. It's, those are the notes in that. This scale, I guess, again, this is my crazy symbol for it, and I just call it a C dominant 7 scale. It's basically just like a regular C major scale, but it has the flat 7 in it as well, so it's just like etc. In terms of trying to communicate it, I think I'd call it a jazz minor scale. It's just in this particular key, it's in B minor, and it has the natural 7 and the raised 7 in it. This is the second of the minor jazz scales, and this one's in A, and it's the only difference between this one and the other one is they both of the jazz minor scales have the raised 7, but the previous one had the natural 7 in it, and this one doesn't. It just has the raised 7, the 6th, the flat 6th, or the raised 5th, however you want to look at it. Well, before I tell you about this last scale, there's obviously a lot of scales, and the thing is that a lot of them that I've experimented with don't complete themselves in one octave. They take two octaves and sometimes three. But rather than trying to get into those right now, this particular scale I've used quite a lot as a scale to modulate from one chord to another, or because it's a symmetrical scale, so it has a sound that you can recognize when you kind of hear it. And I'm not sure how you go about naming what key it belongs to. But for me, I think of this one as basically like a C minor, because a C minor, an E minor, or an A flat minor, because here you've got like the A flat minor and an A flat major triad, an A flat, a G minor and a G major triad at the same time. But as you can see, it's a perfectly symmetrical scale, so you can have some fun with that one. I try not to practice anything that I'm going to play, in as much as, like, I don't learn any particular licks or something that I can just play, so I'm stringing a bunch of licks together, because that's not the way I think about improvising. I just think, again, about all of the notes, you know, that are available, and you just try and make melodies out of them, and don't let your hands dictate what you think you can do. Take a look at those fingerboard charts and imagine your eyes like dancing on the notes that you want to play, and then forget about whether your hands can do it or not. Just try it. Like I said, a name is only to transmit the information or to communicate it to someone else. And really the communication that we're doing, that we're speaking about really, is music, which you don't shout the changes to the people. They only hear the music, and that's the only thing that matters. Well, I guess I started with the legato thing by accident, because I didn't really know what was happening, and I always wanted to play a horn, so I guess subconsciously I was trying to make the guitar sound more like a horn. I never really wanted to play the guitar. I don't really like the guitar for me. I love to hear other people play the guitar, of course, but it's just that it wasn't the instrument that I think I would have chosen. If I'd have been given a saxophone earlier, for example, I would have much preferred that. But my dad bought me a guitar instead, and saxophones were pretty expensive at the time, so I ended up noodling on the guitar. And I started out literally just noodling, because I had no interest in the instrument, and it just developed over a period of time. So then I started to think, well, you know, an instrument, by nature of its name, just means it's a tool, like a spanner or a wrench or a screwdriver. It's something that you can use to get a job done. So because I love music, I ended up trying to do it with this. So I suppose I've spent the rest of my life, or going to try to spend the rest of my life, trying to make the guitar sound like it's not a guitar. And that's where the legato thing came in, because I just wanted it to be a lot more fluid than was natural for this particular percussive instrument to be. The title for this tune came from me kind of falling out of the pub one night back in England, and there was this old guy walking down the street, and I guess he must have seen all of us hooligans coming out of the pub, and he just looked at us and he said, "Boy, the things you see when you haven't got your gun." So here it is. The chord sequence for this is it's really simple, and we play over the changes, like I said, before they actually occur in the head at the end, or when we return to the thing. So, well, basically, it's just an A flat to D flat to D flat minor to A flat minor to like a A minor major 7 to an F sharp. And then a kind of like a C minor over E. To A flat. That was basically the first few chords, but the solo section of this tune, we actually play over the sequence before the sequence occurs in the head. So we solo over changes that haven't yet been heard until you get to the end of the tune. Chad Wackerman just did a solo album recently, and the album's called 40 Reasons, and we've been playing a tune from his album, and this one's called Tell Me. We'll be right back.
We asked Allan if it was easier or more difficult for him to improvise over his own compositions.
Quite often the funniest thing is people will say, oh, well, you write your own tunes, so it's easy to play on your own tunes. But it's not, for me, easy to play on my own tunes. Sometimes I'll write a tune and then have a terrible hard time with it. It's just that when I'm writing the tune, I'm not considering how difficult it's going to end up being to solo over. I don't think about that till it's done. Then when it's done, I go, how am I going to do that?
Allan Holdsworth has long been known for his incredible single-note improvising, but Allan is also a master of beautiful and unusual chordal playing. Coming up next from his home studio, Allan shows us how he comes up with his unique chord voicings.
People ask me a lot about chords and the way I think about chords, and the way I do think about chords is I just think of them as being, say, members of a family. And I think of a four-note chord, for example, which most guitar chords are, as just being four members of a family. Say you have imagine a seat with eight family members on it, and you say, four stand up, Stephen, George, Sarah, Winston, or whatever, stand up. And then you take a picture of those, and that's that particular chord. But they're all members of that one family. So when I hear chords moving from one chord to another, I don't just hear the static voicing of that one particular chord, although that may be important in a head, say, for example. I see it more as being the families that change as you change from one chord to the next. So I just think of chords as being based on scales. So I try to hear the scale shapes move, you know, from one family to the next as the chords go by. Well, one of the things that might happen to you is if somebody says, okay, play me an E major 7 chord, which is a pretty primitive chord, and you'd say, if you haven't been playing very long, you might just play but that's a really ugly, disgusting, dissonant sounding chord to me. So you could play another inversion of that, say, which sounds a whole lot nicer. Or instead of playing just an inversion of those notes, you could play groups of notes from that family. By family, I mean the scale in which that chord is part of. For instance, you could play some of these chords, which are all based on the E major scale. So if somebody said to you, okay, we're gonna play a D minor chord now, a D minor 7, D minor 11 chord, What would you play? You know, so again, instead of just playing an inversion of a chord, which you could do, a nice inversion, say, There are lots of other things that you could do as well based on just the notes in the scale. So I'm just going to give you a few examples of those. These are pretty basic chords, so as you can see, like a C major, D minor, G7 chord, any one of these notes from the scale will work. So now I'm just going to play some more examples of using the same notes from the same family, but now they're going to be kind of related to C major as opposed to D minor. Okay, so now I'm going to give you a few examples of chords built on the scale, the minor major 7 with a flat 5 or a raised 4, however you want to look at that. And here it is. Here's some more examples, same scale, like this one's in F, an F minor major 7 with a raised 4. This would be a good time to check out the charts, because that way you can take a chord or a voicing that you really like and see if you can fit it or find it somewhere in the scale, and then take each one of those notes and move it up to the next step in that particular scale. That's all these are, they're just chord scales. So here's another example. I'd like to give you another example. This one's just like, say, a D-flat 7 augmented chord, and I'm just going to base all of these other chords that you'll hear around the scale, and they're not different inversions of that chord, they're just based on the scales again. These 10 charts that I drew up, I think for me they're the most usable and practical scales, because they allow you to improvise using these scales over most of the chords that you would come across. I mean, there are more, obviously, and there's hundreds of thousands of different scales and you go crazy trying to figure it all out. But I think these are very useful scales, particularly the first 5, because they're more harmonically defined than the last 5, which I group as the jazz scales. The jazz scales have extra notes, and one extra note usually in each one, which makes them in some ways a little more ambiguous, but nevertheless, I think they're really useful, and I think it's good to know them. And like I said, when you look at these charts, try and see the whole neck as if they were all lit up, you know, all those dots are lit up on the neck, and try and memorize those, so when you see chords go by, you see all of these notes changing under your hand. So you can make melodies from them. The idea is really to make music, because really names, like I said before, they're not important. It's just the language that we're trying to speak is music. So that's the bottom line. If you can make melody from the thing and make some music out of it, then it's okay. Well, this tune is called House of Mirrors, because it kind of reminds me of like being in a house of mirrors, because it modulates a lot, and I like that. You know, I've always, that's why that system of numbering chords, like for example 2-5-1 or whatever, doesn't really work too well for me with my music, because they move around too much to ever have one that stays a one. But I guess because this tune does modulate a lot, that's where I came up with the title House of Mirrors. Well, I'd like to thank all the chaps, you know, Skúli Sverrisson on bass, Steve Hunt keyboards, and Chad Wackerman drums for really helping me out on this. They did a great job, and thank you, chaps. Well, I hope it wasn't too much of a miserable experience, and I'd really like to think that you can get something from this. And the thing that I really wanted to get over is that I really am a big believer in trying to figure out ways to do things on your own, because then they become more meaningful to you. You understand them on a much deeper level than you would if you were just repeating something parrot fashion or something that someone else showed you. Because sometimes, even though you would know or understand eventually what you'd been shown, for some reason there seems to be something missing in that for me. So I really like to encourage everybody to try and work really hard on their own to develop themselves. So good luck.